Matt, because the Laramie Hospital couldn't handle such a massive head trauma, that Matt's chances of survival were not good, and that if he did survive, there was a good chance he would be in a vegetative state. So we discussed all those issues on the way over, knowing that we'd have to make that decision when we got there.
Mm-hmm. Long plane ride.
And when you arrived in the United States, you realized that this was a national story.
Yeah, that was a big surprise to us and distressing as well. We had no idea, because we'd been traveling for 24 hours, what had transpired. We had no idea why Matthew had been beaten or who had done it or any of those details. And then we land in the Minneapolis airport to pick up our younger son. Mm-hmm. And there on the front page of the Minneapolis newspaper is a picture of Matthew, and it was quite a shock.
And then you realized exactly what had happened.
But we began to hear details, and it was, you're in this state of trying to make things right, trying to be there for Matt and fix it, and mm-hmm. We shut all of that out.
Mm-hmm. The next 6 days were, I have to imagine, some of the worst, because Matthew fought.
Yeah, he did.
For 6 days, and then he finally did pass away. And then before he passed away, they did find the two men who were responsible, Russell Henderson and Aaron McKinney.
Mm-hmm.
I know that Russell Henderson pled guilty,
right?
But McKinney went to trial.
Right.
You sat there. Mrs. Shepherd, spoken to a lot of victims' parents, and a lot of them can't do it, but you decided you wanted to be in that courtroom and hear how your son brutally was killed.
Well, I had to show the jury that Matt had a family who loved him, that he was more than a newspaper article or a photo on the headline news, that he was loved and cherished and had friends and family who really missed him.
It had to be the toughest thing in the world.
It was very hard.
Before your son's death, I know that you and your husband supported the death penalty, and Matthew did as well.
We had discussed James Byrd Jr. incident while Matthew was still alive.
But I understand that during McKinney's trial, you began to rethink that decision. What happened?
Well, there were two things that happened. One was, what kind of a message were we trying to send to the rest of the world? Now that the world was part of our life in this aspect, we wanted to think about what kind of message we were sending, that violence really wasn't, further violence wasn't going to fix anything. So. That was one of the considerations. And the other is that if we had gone ahead and sought the death penalty, we would be dealing with this man for the rest of our lives. More trials, more hearings, more press, more. And he agreed to the same sentence as Henderson, which was two consecutive life sentences with no appeal. It was as close to being over as it could be.
Well, at the sentencing hearing, your husband actually read a prepared statement that spared his life. And mm-hmm. I want to read the last couple of lines of that statement. He said, you robbed me of something. He's talking to McKinney. You robbed me of something very precious, and I will never forgive you for that. Mr. McKinney, I give you life in the memory of one who no longer lives. May you have a long life, and may you thank Matthew every day for it. Do you think in some way that life without parole is the ultimate punishment for this man?
Well, I certainly don't think it's compassionate. It's he's a very young man. He's 22 or 23 now, was the same age as Matthew. And the rest of his life in this building. I just can't imagine anything more horrifying.
Anybody has that idea out there has to know that this is what's going to happen to you.
That's right. And the movie that we're showing, there are lots of things we want people to realize. And one of the things is potential perpetrators who may be thinking or mm-hmm. feeling this hatred, this hate language, is that this is what happens. Your life is destroyed right along with the victims and their families and your own family.
Right. Tell us about the Matthew Shepherd Foundation.
Well, Dennis and I started the foundation soon after Matthew died. People began to send money in memorial. And we knew we wanted to follow with Matt's values and his wishes and his dreams. So we created this foundation to help gay and lesbian organizations, in particular, mm-hmm. young people at risk. There are many young people on the street now because they've been rejected by their families or their communities. And that's a goal of the foundation, is to find some way to help them be safe and live the life they were meant to lead.
Well, you're doing something about it by just coming and talking about it.
I'm giving it every chance I get.
You know what Matthew wanted to do with his life?
He was very interested in helping people's social justice issues, and after having lived overseas for 3 or 4 years, he wanted to go back and foreign service, humanitarian aid, those kinds of things. He was very gifted at languages. And
well, this is a real legacy for him if he's dealing with social justice, because that's exactly what you're doing now.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
Thank you so much.
Thank
for joining us.
It.
Our thanks to Judy Shepherd. The Matthew Shepherd story airs Saturday night. Again, it's must-see television for everybody in this country. We'll be right back.
next guests were the very first musical act to take the stage here at The View. So, they were here before I was, but I'm so thrilled that I'm with them now, because please welcome Amy Ray and Emily Saylors, better known as Indigo Girls. Welcome back to the show. Okay, you two have known each other since high school, and this is your 11th album, Become You. What has it been like? How have you been able to stay such good friends while working together so closely?
Well, we have a lot of respect for each other. Amy's a great person, a great writer. She does things musically that I can't do. Also, on a personal level, our families are very connected. We've actually known each other since elementary school. And we're very conscientious about keeping things fresh, like making new set lists for live performances and making the records we want to make creatively. And then when we have time off from the road, Amy goes her way and I go my way. And she's got her own record label and I own a restaurant with some other partners. So we do separate things as well as together things. So I think we have a very balanced perspective on life and work.
Well, we're thrilled because you're about to sing A Moment of Forgiveness in a little bit. And Amy, you wrote the lyrics to this song. What is the message behind it?
It's one of those songs where it's like you wake up in the middle of the night and you've been single for a couple of years and maybe you screwed up the last thing you were in and you are like, what am I doing here by myself? So I just wrote it really quickly. It was like kind of like just a little ditty, little country song.
And that's something we can all relate to.
Yeah, I mean, definitely. But it's like, you know, maybe it's time to be vulnerable, put it out there again and be willing to say you're sorry, you know.
Well, I want to ask you about something that's been in the news this week, and that's Rosie O'Donnell. She just came out.
Yay, Rosie.
You two have been out for many years now. What kind of effect do you think that her coming out will have on her audience and so on, and how people will react to her?
Well, I think it all works together in the evolution of civil rights for gay people, and I think it's very important for someone in the public eye like Rosie to come out. We're happy that she has. I think there's a lot of ignorance about gay people, and a lot of people don't even think that they know anybody who's gay or have any relationship. And a lot of people feel like Rosie's even part of their family, you know, and she's very beloved by so many people in this country. So to have someone come out and say, I'm a lesbian who is beloved by so many Americans is a very, very positive step. But it's also like hearing Judy Shepherd speak.
Absolutely.
I mean, I'm so moved by that. Mm. And it all works together. It's the work that Judy does, and it's the work that Rosie's doing, and it's the work that we try to be part of. And eventually we'll see a day where people will look back and as these are dark days of hatred and homophobia.
And hopefully what happened to Matthew Shepherd will never happen anymore.
Right, that's the goal, is, common human dignity and peace with diversity.
Right. Well, we're thrilled because we get to hear you sing right now. You don't have to wait any longer, because here to perform Moment of Forgiveness from their new CD, Become You, let's hear the Indigo Girls.
Well, I guess that I was lonely, that's why I called you on the phone. 'Cause in a moment of forgiveness, I didn't wanna be alone. And I guess that I was willing more than I ever was before. At your door. that you were gone. It's been too long, years without you. When are you gonna come home? I guess I was hoping that you finally understand. And in a moment of forgiveness, you reach out and take my hand.
Stores now. We'll be right back.